Good afternoon, everybody. I think we've had a few more people join us, so we'll begin from here. Welcome to the final webinar of this week of webinars as part of our Pass It On campaign here. Today it's the How to Buy Your First Home. I'm Blair. I work here at Hargreaves Lansdown on the marketing side and have myself recently been one of those many individuals looking for all the help and information I can get to buy my first home. Obviously, it's still a key milestone for everyone in life at the moment, and one that many of us are still reaching for. And we've obviously got a whole new generation starting this journey to home ownership and needing to understand the ins and outs of getting there. So, with this in mind, I'm delighted to introduce to you our main speaker today, Sarah Coles, who will be guiding us through how to buy your first home. And I couldn't think of a better person to do it. Sarah is a consumer champion, and it's not just me who thinks so. Sarah recently won the Headline Money's Expert of the Year at their latest awards. She joined Hargreaves in 2017 after 14 years as a financial journalist, where she worked for the likes of Bloomberg and Moneywise before going freelance. She also provides insight analysis to the media and co-presents our Switch Your Money On podcast, which is a great listen if you don't already. Her expertise range across so many things, from savings and financial planning to tax, borrowing, spending, and the housing market. Sorry if I've embarrassed you a little bit there, Sarah.
Hi. So yes, as Blair said, I'm head of personal finance. I have bought my own home. I've actually started from the bottom twice because I'd like to live my life in a completely non-linear way. I'd say it is possible at every stage. It's obviously really challenging. I would say I'm really hoping nobody's come to this expecting a magical solution, because I really wish there was one, but there really isn't. So the aim of today is to sort of arm you with all the possible avenues you can take, the understanding of sort of what it entails, some ideas about some of the help you can get along the way, and hopefully sort of help you further down the track. But if I could give everybody, do an Oprah and give everybody a house, I absolutely would.
I'd love
So I'll
if you
just
could do that.
yes, not necessarily going to happen. So I'll take you through just the agenda, and then we'll crack on.
So before we kick off, I went over just a few important elements. We have an hour today for this. The presentation should last around 40 minutes, so we'll have 15 minutes or so for questions. Please raise any questions you have via the Q&A section. I'll look through it as we go along and then ask as many as we can towards the end. I do need to stress, as Sarah kind of hinted towards, everything discussed here is purely informational and is not financial advice. Given the time constraints we've got, we can't cover absolutely everything, but we hope that what we do talk through will enable you to go away and make decisions for a more informed position. We'll also record the session and we will send out a recording of this via email to you guys. So if we're ready, without further ado, I'll hand you over to Sarah.
Thank you. So, but the kind of structure of what I'm going to take you through today is we're going to start with kind of the reasons why people are buying. It's worth asking sort of whether now is a good time to buy, because obviously there's an awful lot going on in the housing market. So it's worth having a little bit of a closer look at that. I'll go through a bit about mortgages, a bit of kind of some of the questions regarding whether buying on your own or coupling up. And by coupling up, I don't necessarily mean suddenly, finding the love of your life overnight. It can be buying with anybody else. Then there's some questions around saving for your first home, buying with a lifetime ISA and the difference that can make, some thoughts about your first home, and then the question of whether the money you put aside should be in cash or it should be invested. Now, yes, I would say it's quite one of the things I will say is when we go through whether it's worth cash investing, it's really important you do the right thing for you. So it's very unusually, there'll be times when I'll be saying, don't put your money anywhere near where we are because we invest. With our lifetime ISAs and some people the right option will be cash. So we'll go through it properly in detail and you can make sort of get to understand what it means for you. But as this sort of it's worth knowing that the different things are right for different people. So we're going to start by if anyone's willing to say, so really wanted to know why you are buying, so why you want to buy. So if you're happy to share it, I mean, with me, I was sick of not being able to put things on my walls. It was that straightforward. And I was obviously I'm a bit long in the tooth. It was an easier challenge for me back then, but it was still virtually impossible. And we ended up buying a teeny, 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 tiny property in order to be able to afford, and then falling over each other for years. So yes, I would say that was my reason for buying. I don't know if you want to put any comments in the chat or in the Q&A, let us know why you want to buy. I've got some contact, I think, from people who are trying to join the webinar, which I will just forward on to the team. So I guess we should start with whether now is a good time to buy. So I'm just going to do that. Great. So there are lots of things to go into here. So I will do a whistle stop tour. So the first thing, obviously, is house prices are high. So affordability is a real issue. So figures from Zoopla showed that house prices in England are likely to be around 6.3 times the average income by the end of the year. So this has actually come down, which is excellent news. It's still obviously ridiculously high. And also it's happened at the same time as the change in mortgage rates, which means that despite the fact that technically they're more affordable, in reality, they're not more affordable. And even though they have come down, so the Office for National Statistics said the average property costs £288,000. Now, if you think about putting down a 10% deposit on that, that's somehow finding £28,800 out of the blue in order to put down as a deposit. So it goes to show just the scale of the challenge. The question, you know, on everyone's lips is what's going to happen to house prices, and house prices could fall from here. So we've seen them come down from the peak. Depending on which of the indices you look at, they've either come down by £5,000 or by £14,000. So it's quite a variety, but definitely they have come down from the peak. And prices are expected to fall throughout this year. So the issue if house prices fall is obviously if you buy with a small deposit, then you could end up in what's known as negative equity, which means that if you owe more on your mortgage than the property is worth, then you're considered to be in negative equity, which I'll go through in a minute. It's worth also knowing that in some areas, house prices are likely to fall further than in others. So if you're looking to buy somewhere where house prices are particularly high, or whether they've risen loads in really recent history, then those are considered to be vulnerable areas, that they're likely to, you know, be more vulnerable to falling than other areas. I've got here that we could be heading for a recession. I mean, luckily, the ONS has done some, sorry, Office for National Statistics, has done some recalibrations and thinks actually things aren't quite so bad on the growth front as they had thought. So we are more likely to be heading for the joys of stagnation rather than for recession at the moment. But it is worth noting that one of the things that's been a bit of a constant in recent years is that the jobs market has been fairly strong. And more recently, we've seen vacancies really drop. We've seen unemployment start to rise. So Office for Budget Responsibility is not predicting a massive increase in job insecurity, but it is showing some increase. So it's one of those questions, you know, people are worried that they might lose their job. And if they bought a house, they're made of commitment, and it becomes a concern for people. Then there's also the question that mortgage rates are still really high. So the way that mortgage rates work is that they're tied to the Bank of England base rate. But if you have a fixed rate mortgage, it's actually that tie is really not totally straightforward. So actually, it's based on expectations for mortgages in the future. So if you were to fix for like 2 years, then that your fix will depend on what generally the market thinks is going to happen to interest rates over that 2 year period. Now, going back about 6 weeks, the market was really worried. It thought that interest rates were going to be much, much higher. And so it was making fixed rates even more expensive. Those expectations have come back. We're starting to see some movement in inflation figures, which has convinced the market it doesn't need quite so many interest rate rises, which means that those are starting to come off. Now, regardless of all this movement, we're still looking at interest rates at about 6.7%. And if you look at sort of where they were, you know, 18 months ago, 2 years ago, you know, further down the track, you're able to fix for less than 2%. So this is a significant change, and it makes a really big difference. It is well worth, there's loads of mortgage calculators online. It's worth going in, putting in, you know, if they are 6.7, what am I paying? You know, can I afford to sort of meet that each month, just to get an understanding of what it actually means for you. On the plus side, it's a buyer's market. So we know that demand is down about a third from the 5-year average, and sales in this particular year are expected to be around about 1 million, which is the lowest for more than a decade. Now, the reason why this is good for buyers is it means you can drive a harder bargain. So if you're worried that price is going to fall, you can build that into the asking price. So you can say, right, well, I'm going to need a 5% discount in order to consider buying. So it means that you have the power to negotiate if you are in a position to buy. In the long run, so I talked about negative equity, the long run, it is worth considering whether it matters to you if prices fall. Now, it's terrifying if prices fall and you've got a small deposit, but it might not be the end of the world. So if you say, for example, if you've fixed your mortgage for 5 years, if you plan to stay put, you know, don't want to move anywhere else for 5 years, and house prices fall, as long as they recover within 5 years, it's not the end of the world. So it is always one of those things. It's a really big fear, and it's really obvious why. But I remember years and years ago, I talked to people who bought at the peak just before a massive crash, and some of them bought back when Canary Wharf was sort of mainly mud and a few houses, and people had bought there and the house prices completely collapsed. And by the time I spoke to them, it had completely recovered. So it feels like it's never going to recover, but actually house prices do. It's worth noting. I mean, obviously no guarantees, they can go up as well as down. But technically, if you're in it for the long term, it's not the big deal that it feels if it's happening to you right now. One of the other issues is about the wait and see approach. So in your mind, you might be thinking, well, I'll just wait, house prices will fall, and then I'll buy when they've fallen. Now, lots of things can happen. One of the things is you're currently in a buyer's market. When house prices start to rise again, you'll likely to be in a seller's market. So you won't be able to do those negotiations, and you might be competing with lots of other people, which will actually push up prices much faster. You might also be renting at the point when house prices are rising, and you might be tied in for 6 months. And by the time you get to the end of that 6 months, house prices may have risen back up to where they are now or beyond. So there's no guarantees involved in waiting and seeing. Now, that might be that you still want to wait and see, or you may have absolutely no choice about waiting and seeing. But it's worth remembering that on paper, it seems like one of those things you can do quite easily, but really think it through in your own circumstances and think, how quickly will I be in a position to move, when things change? And am I confident that in my particular area, things are going to work in exactly the way I expect? Because it's one of the, very different in reality than it is on paper. And then the other question that obviously is about rentals. So it's worth factoring in, actually, if you're ready to buy and you don't, and you decide to rent instead, then there's the question of, well, actually, you're just spending lots and lots of money on rent, and rents are going up incredibly fast. Most recent statistics I saw, so there's about 20 renters per available property, which means that we're going to see those rents keep going up, which is, and also it means you might not be able to find anywhere to rent, even if you really want to, which is, I'm sure, something that everyone is experiencing at the moment. So if we go to the next slide, I want to take you a little bit through mortgages. So the first question is how much you can borrow. Now, lenders tend to work in multiples of income. So most people are offered up to 4.5 times their annual earnings. So that's single earnings or joint earnings, depending on whether you're buying on your own or with someone else. The limit is because the Bank of England stops them from lending a big chunk of their loan book over this amount. So the regulator says to the banks, you can't have more than 15% of your loan book over this. So it does mean they might make an exception in your circumstances if you're in a particularly good position, although particularly confident that in your ability to pay the mortgage, but largely you are limited to that 4.5. Generally, you can borrow up to 95% of the property value, but the old rule applies. The bigger the deposit in terms of percentage, then the better rate you're more likely to get, the more choice you're more likely to have. And it does tend to mean that it's much, much easier to pay the mortgage. So there is that whole balance between getting on the property ladder as soon as possible and not having a massive percentage mortgage that people need to really look at. There are plenty of mortgages now available offering, with a 5% deposit. And there are some offering, 100% mortgages still. So there are those options. So if we look at the types of mortgages, there's fixed and variable. Now, apologies if you know this, I will go really fast. and so if it's something you already know, I'll be over in a flash. So the types of mortgages, variable include things like tracker mortgages, and they will track what the Bank of England is doing. Now, at the moment, obviously, we've had all these Bank of England rises, so tracker rates are becoming more and more expensive. We're expecting at least one more rate rise. We may have another one after that. Generally, the market's expecting no more after that, but they're not expecting cuts either. So generally, obviously, these things are always, finger in the air, but we do feel that the kind of interest rate cycle is coming close to the end. So we're not going to see those tracker rates go up lots more, but they will go up more. And obviously, if you get a huge surprise out of the blue and everything changes, they can go up more. The other type of variable rate is a standard variable rate. Now, these are really expensive, and you normally only end up on them if you've sort of finished with a fixed rate or with a tracker or whatever it is, and you revert to the standard variable rate, which means that rate suddenly applies to you. They're really high. If you're in a position to move from that, you tend to move straight away. It's only you're kind of stuck on it because your circumstances have changed and you're really struggling to get another mortgage. And then there's also fixed rates. So fixed rates tend to be higher, but they're guaranteed not to change for the rate of the fix. So if you fix for 2 years, you know exactly what you're paying over that 2 year period. You can fix for 2 years, you can fix for 5 years, and you can get fixes for up to 10 years as well. So what's happening to rates right now? Well, as I've said, they have shot up. So the fixed rates, because of the way that rate expectations moved, so it started really moving directly after the mini budget, which was at the end of last year, and they kind of shot up loads. They started to creep down gradually. We had a nasty surprise with some inflation figures, which everyone was thinking, oh my goodness, inflation's never going to come down. So they ramped up again, and they've started to float down again. So they've kind of been up and down and up and down, but they're roughly around 6.7% now. If you compare that to the middle of June, the average 2-year fix was just under 6%. So you can see that it's not moving massively. It's still at that quite high elevated level. So it's worth knowing kind of that's roughly the ballpark that we're in at the moment. And generally, we are going to have to wait until the Bank of England stops raising interest rates before we see any significant cuts. So it's not just that they stop raising, we are then expecting them to hold for quite a long time. So you're looking at the period when the market thinks, okay, it's probably going to cut. And that's really unpredictable as to when that will happen, but we know that it's going to be quite a long way down the track. The more underlying strength that we manage to find in the economy, then the longer it's going to be before we see those cuts. So when the Office for National Statistics said, oh, we've got a bit more growth than we thought, then actually for interest rate, that means interest rates are likely to be a bit higher for a bit longer. So so that's basically what's happening to rates right now. So can you bring your monthly payments down? Well, yes, you can. The best way to do it is through shopping around, and that's really, really key. It's difficult to shop around because you need to know exactly, you need to go through the process with so many different organisations in order to get a realistic quote from them. It's one reason why using a broker can be a really good idea, especially if you're looking for a specific sort of mortgage in a specific, sort of way. They do know who is looking for borrowers like you, and they can really help. You may have to pay for their advice, but it may be something, there are some that will work on a commission basis, and they will, you know, it's one of those things. If you're struggling to get a mortgage, it can make a difference, and they can really bring down that cost. Obviously, the less you borrow, the lower the payments are, which obviously is one of the reasons why having a bigger deposit is a good idea. You can actually use offsetting for this, and this is where you get a sort of structured product which has got a mortgage in there and it's got a savings product in there. You can stick money in the savings and it gets offset, so you only pay, it gets basically subtracted from the debt, and therefore you only pay interest on the difference. So it does mean that you're not sort of necessarily putting all of it into the mortgage, so you're not inextricably stuck there. It means that if you have another reason, an emergency, something else you need the money for, you can take it out, but in the short term it's meaning that you're paying less interest. You can stretch the mortgage for longer with a 30-year mortgage. Now, that's incredibly common now. So it does mean that you're paying more interest in total because you're stretching it for longer. You're paying interest in more months, which means that you're eventually going to have a much bigger interest bill. However, it does mean smaller monthly payments, which makes them more manageable. So as long as you understand the sort of the price you're paying for, it can be a really, really good option. One of the things I would say, one of the most overlooked ways to bring a mortgage down is to compromise. Now, obviously, when you're looking for a house, compromise is the name of the game. Otherwise, we would all be living in detached houses that cost nothing and, in the middle of an ideal location. So compromise is absolutely key. And the more compromises you can make and the more affordable the house is, then the less, of a sort of commitment that you've made financially. So you can compromise on location, size, type of property, size of outdoor space, features like garages or even the condition. That's one of the really big differences that can make it. If it's not in poor condition, if you're prepared to put a lot of work in, actually it can make a major difference to how much you pay. So it is worth thinking about the compromise that works for you. But I would also say, so if you remember, I said we bought this absolutely tiny place and fell over each other for years. We made the compromise on size. It was a compromise that we were prepared to live with for the long term, but it was really hard. You have to bear in mind that you can't be switching and changing. You can't make a compromise that in a couple of years' time you think, oh, don't like this. Because the more often you move, the more expensive the whole process gets. So I would really, it's a lot of sort of complicated thinking things through, but it's definitely worth bearing in mind. Okay, so what will happen to rates next? So we're expecting, as I say, they're going to back off a bit, but they're not going to back off substantially for a long period. So it is worth adding at this stage that this is always, a process by which we're trying to work out what's likely to happen. At any given moment, we could get, you only have to look at, the invasion of Ukraine to know that there is a huge shock that could hit the economy from nowhere that we don't know about right now. So all of these predictions we're making is based on all the knowledge that we have. But if something, something is currently sitting in somebody's head, we just don't know about it. So when you're making all these predictions, you also need to factor in okay, what if these predictions are wrong? How much will it then cost me? And what do I need to do to be able to pay for it? So it's kind of plan A, you can expect what you can expect, but also you need to be prepared if the unexpected happens. Cheerful, I know, sorry. Okay, if we move to the next slide. So this is about whether you're buying a loan or coupling up. Now, as I said, coupling up doesn't necessarily mean with a partner. You can buy with a family member. So people might choose to buy with a sibling, or sometimes they might choose to buy with their parents. So there are different people that you can buy with. It makes a vast difference. So obviously there's some real benefits. So the affordability is based on you both. So I talked about that 4.5 times salary. It's either 4.5 times single or 4.5 times joint. Makes a massive difference to how much you can borrow. Saving up for the deposit is easiest. I mean, we know from the work that we do with the barometer that being single is incredibly expensive. So you're dealing with all the expenses on your own. And, you know, if you're living alone when you're renting, then actually it's much, much harder to build a deposit. If you live together and rent, much easier to build a deposit, and then much easier to pay for the mortgage when you buy. You can both use your lifetime house, provided you're both in, you know, the right position. So it's your first property and that you're both the right age and all those sorts of things. So you may be able to get the benefits. I'm going to go into the LISA or the lifetime house in a little while, but just bear in mind that you might be able to use it. And then obviously the monthly bills are easier to manage. Now, in terms of the downsides, there can be issues around how you own it. Those are not insurmountable. So one of you might have a lot more money coming in, you might have a bigger deposit, you know, then you might need to talk to each other about whether you want to own it together 50-50, or whether you want to own it in different amounts. And you can do that. So the differences between being joint tenants and being tenants in common. Tenants in common means that you can sort of own it in different ways. And it also means, for example, if you bought with your best mate and you were to pass away, then your part of the property would pass to the people that you choose, rather than necessarily going to your best friend. You might choose to give it to them, but if you don't, you can make your own choices about that. So it's a cheerful way of putting it, but there are issues around how you own it. There's the question of what happens if someone misses payment. So you're both responsible for the whole mortgage. So if the other person doesn't pay, that's your debt too. You really need to think about that. And overall, because you've both got a joint product, it means that you've linked your credit rating. So if they have problems with other sorts of debt, so credit cards or anything like that, then that can affect your own ability to borrow. So that is worth knowing. It's no different if you're, you know, married or if you're buying with a friend. The two things, as soon as you have a joint product, that's the key that they start to link you. It doesn't matter if you live together, doesn't matter if you're married, it's the joint product that really makes it count. So sometimes if your friend's living together, you'll draw up an agreement covering all of this sort of thing. You can also cover kind of what happens if. So if one of you misses payments, you know, what happens then? Does one of you, the other one, have to step in? Do their family have to step in? So you need to kind of make an arrangement for that. What happens if you've got different approaches? So, you know, when you live with anyone, you can have different approaches to anything, you know, whether it's like cleaning or maintenance or, but really the, you know, the priority of paying the bills, it can be very difficult to be living with someone. You're both responsible for paying the mortgage and the other person is less responsible for money. So it's important to have all these sorts of agreements in place. And you can also cover there what will happen if your circumstances change. So it might be that you arrange for one of you to buy the other one out, or that you can sell your bit of it on to someone else. You know, there are lots of different solutions, but you need to bear in mind, I mean, this much easier to have this conversation if you're buying with friends than it is to have the conversation if you're buying with a partner. Actually, it's brilliant to have it with a partner so that you can have this, have this conversation, you've got it out, and you know where you stand, you know, if your circumstances change. Quite difficult to do, much, much more easy if you're buying with, you know, your family or friends. If we can, I should also mention that there are lots of other ways you can get some help. So you coupling up makes a huge difference, but also you can look at other ways you can get help. So this is really where your broader family comes in. So it might be that you buy with broader family. It might be that they help out in other ways. So they might be able to help you with the deposit, for example. The bank of mum and dad is one of the biggest lenders in the UK. If you're not able to get help from your parents, then there are other ways of doing it, but it can make such an enormous difference that if any member of the family is considering giving any money to any of the other members of the family and they can accelerate that to help them buy a property, it's really worth thinking about. If they can't afford, so if you family can't give you a lump sum, there are other options. So there's things like the family offset mortgage. So you remember I talked about the offset mortgage where your savings kind of offset your debt. Family versions of that is their savings can offset your debt as well. On the flip side, they won't get any interest on their savings, but they might be prepared to pop in an account for a period of time to really help out while your mortgage is bigger. There's other sorts of family mortgages which can help as well. So they can use their savings as security, for example, which will help you get a mortgage. But there's lots of risks involved that they need to understand. So they, for example, if you've got a family mortgage, they are taking on a responsibility to make sure that you're paying it. Some parents will also be prepared to help with the monthly payment, which can make a huge difference. Some of them will do it informally. You can also get a mortgage with two borrowers and one owner. However, again, they're jointly responsible for the mortgage. So you're the only owner, but they are jointly responsible. So they do need to know the risks. If you think a specialist mortgage is the right answer for you, I really, again, I'd recommend considering a broker. So there are, you know, they will know these options and they will be able to explain the pros and cons through, you know, even more detail than I just rattled off now. And it is, there are, you know, they can be brilliant for people. They can be a real problem. So it is definitely worth getting a full balance picture before you get into it. Okay, the other place you can get help is the government. So that's where I'm just going to run into now. So if we move to the next slide. So this is the lifetime ISA. So there are lots of benefits to using a lifetime ISA. So the idea is that if you're aged 18 to 39, you can use a lifetime ISA to save up to £4,000 in each tax year. And the government will add a 25% bonus. So that's if you put your £4,000 in, the government will top that up by another £1,000. So it is a lot of, you know, it will make a major difference. Now, there are loads of bits of small print with lifetime ISA. It's almost as if the product was specifically designed with small print in mind. But it's such a great boost to your, you know, to your savings for a property that it is worth kind of getting to grips with all of the small print, seeing if it is right for you. So I'm now going to run through all the ins and outs of it really quickly, just to give you an idea. So we always say that tax rules for lifetime ISA can change, and the benefits will depend on your circumstances. You can withdraw money from the lifetime ISA to buy your first home. And the other thing that can be used for is in retirement, which obviously, you know, that's a whole other subject, which we won't go into now. But if you take out the money for any other reason, then the government will charge you 25%, which actually sounds like they're just taking away their bonus. It's not quite how it works in practice. It means they take away the bonus and a little bit more of your own money. So there is a penalty if you don't end up using it to buy a property, which is really worth understanding. If we move to the next slide. So there we go. There's the small print that I mentioned. So you can find out the stage, really. You find out how much you can borrow, you search for the best mortgage offer, and then you get the money in your lifetime ISA. So it's not a tremendously difficult process. One of the previous products was I helped buy ISA, and that had a slightly more complicated process when it came to buying, whereas this, it sort of can be built quite straightforwardly into the buying process. And there are some rules about the properties you can buy, which I think are on the next slide. Said, crossing our fingers. Yes, so you need to be a first-time buyer. If you have a help to buy ISA, you can only use one, either the help to buy or the lifetime ISA in order to buy a property. You can actually switch from the help to buy ISA into the lifetime ISA, but it's not completely straightforward because you need to switch. Basically, any money that you switch comes out of your lifetime ISA allowance. So for example, if you've got £4,000 and you're helped by ISA, you want to swap it over, it means you can't put anything else into your lifetime ISA in that particular year. The other thing that's worth knowing about the lifetime ISA, which is really widely misunderstood, is it's not in addition to your overall ISA allowance. So your overall ISA allowance of £20,000, if you put £4,000 in your lifetime ISA, then that only leaves you with £16,000 less to put in other ISAs. I say only, obviously, if it's a stretch to save for a property, and £4,000 is an awful lot of money, you might be thinking, well, you know, I think I'll probably be fine, but I just need to sort of run through that detail. It's also, as I said before, if you're buying with another first-time buyer, they can also use their own ISA and bonus, which is another benefit. If you go to the next slide. So there's a few rules around the houses that you can buy with a lifetime ISA. Property's got to be in the UK. It's got to be worth £450,000 or less. So that is one of the real benefits over the help to buy ISA. So say, for example, you're saving into help to buy ISA at the moment, you can only, outside London, you can only buy a property worth £250,000 or less. So if you wanted to buy a £300,000 property, you wouldn't be able to use your help to buy ISA. So you can then switch it into the lifetime ISA over a period of time and then get advantage. It's, you know, it's not ideal, but it's a heck of a lot better to get, you know, the money, the bonus, rather than, you know, getting to the point at the end of your help to buy ISA and thinking, oh, I can't use that. It needs to be your main home or become your main home as soon as it's ready. So if you're buying something that needs an awful lot of work, there is some flexibility about how much work you can do to it. But the idea is to stop people to use this as a sort of buy-to-let wheeze. And then you need to be buying the house with a mortgage, which, you know, I'm sure the vast majority of people are. So, yes, I think that's, again, lots of small print that says basically, if you start saving for a property through a lifetime ISA, you change your mind, you will end up paying that penalty that I talked about. Okay, so we can move to the next slide. Okay, so this is about whether or not you save or invest. So generally, there's sort of some fairly straightforward rules around this. So with a lifetime ISA, you can get a cash version or you can get an investment version. The one we offer is an investment version. But there are some reasons why you might want to consider cash. So if you want to buy in the next 5 years, we tend to say that investment is for five to 10 years or more. So if you want to buy in the next 5 years, investment is just not necessarily the right approach. It generally tends to mean that cash is a better option. Now, you obviously, you know, you will get a reasonable interest rate on it, but it's, you know, you don't have the potential growth that you would have through investment. But you can't really be thinking about that if you're buying in the next 5 years, because if you know, you might get to the end of that 5 years and investments are busily going up and down. And you need more certainty if you're buying in the short term. It's worth saying when you take out your lifetime ISA for the very first time, you have to wait a year before you can buy anyway. But if you want to buy between 1 and 5 years, then cash is your best option. Obviously, it's secure. It says in brackets normally. Obviously, you know, should it not be secure, then, you know, if your provider goes bust, then you will be able to sort of go through the protection process up to £85,000. So your cash is secure in a more complicated way. Typically, they do have lower interest rates. They've obviously improved now that you know, now that the interest rates have risen, but the sort of potential for growth is there. And it does mean that they're unlikely to beat inflation. However, as I keep saying, if you desperately need a specific amount of money in a specific period of time, cash is your friend if that's within the next 5 years. So if you're investing, then that's for 5 years or more. It's you've got a lot more potential for growth. Your money is working a lot harder. And as a result, it's you've got a much better chance of beating inflation. Obviously, you know, the government bonus means that overall it's a heck of a lot better than beating inflation. But even that investment growth gives you a better chance of keeping up. But your money isn't secure and you can get back less than you invest. So that is an issue that's worth knowing about if you're considering investing to buy a property. Obviously, if it's if it's something for the long term, over 5 years or more, it gives you more time to ride out the ups and downs. There are no guarantees. So, you know, investment's got all that potential, but it is definitely worth thinking about all the aspects of it as well. I would say don't be put off by investing. So, you know, if you're looking for the best possible chance to grow your money, one of the things that it's easy to do is to jump one way or the other based on a gut feeling, thinking, oh, I need to be secure, or oh, I want to make the most of my money. Definitely have a think about all of the different aspects of this and which balance works best for you, because it's not your gut needs to make the decision. This is one of those things that, you know, you need to actually sort of think through all the possibilities. So that brings me to the end of what has been a whistle-stop tour. I feel like I've talked for about a year and a half, but I think it's about 35 minutes. We do have some important information, which I feel that I don't necessarily have to read aloud, but we will leave it up in order for you to have a quick read through of the question, of these things yourself. But other than that, I think we can see if anybody has any questions that they'd like me to answer.
Thank you very much, Sarah. You definitely weren't rubbishing on. It was good. Lots of great information in there. And even the basics, you say, going over the basics is always valuable. It's key to understand them ahead of any big financial decisions like this. I definitely really liked finding out that the fact that the Bank of Mum and Dad is one of the biggest lenders in the UK. It's just a great point to provide context for how many people really are looking to family for help in this sort of situation. Before we go on to one of the first audience ones, we mentioned how obviously this is a life milestone for lots of people. Where do you see buying your first home on the list of priorities compared to things like paying off debt?
Yeah, I mean it's one of those peculiar things that you ideally need to deal with everything all at once, which is just it's a lot, particularly if you're starting sort of on the back foot. So I would say, you know, one of the first things to bear in mind is what else is going on in your life. So if you think, I really would like to save towards a new property, or the first property, but you have massive credit card debts, then those are your priority, because they are eating your money by the fact that you're having to pay these debts back and you're having to pay interest. So what I would really say is, generally what we say is, if you've got lots of expensive short-term debt, that is your first priority. And once you've got that under control, then you've got a few things on the plate at the same time. So you've got building your emergency savings, There's things like looking at how much security you have in your general kind of finances. So, for example, you know, do you need life insurance? Do you have good, decent sick pay from your employer? Do you need to add to that with insurances of your own? So have a look at all those things as well. But definitely that's the point at which you should start thinking about saving for the future. And in that mix is going to be saving for a property. What we generally say is that it's difficult to think, I've got to do everything all at once. The best way to do it is to think about how to free up some cash. Once you've worked out how to free it up, which often means making compromises about the things that you actually want. So, you know, the lifestyle you want, where you want to rent, you know, how you want to spend your money. Once you've freed up some cash, it tends to be the case that people will split that up. So some of it will go towards one priority and something will go towards another. It's, you know, you can feel like you're not making enough progress on any front, but it's really important to look at these things in the round, because it's, you know, if you're saving for a first property, but you're also, for example, paying a fortune on your short-term debt, then it doesn't make any sense. You know, you need to make sure that you are covering those bases.
Very good. It makes a lot of sense, of course. So a couple of questions we've got from the audience. One of the first ones is, can you use a lifetime ISA if buying as a couple, but it's only the first time for one of you?
Yes. So I would say that a lot of these things, if you know, there are technical questions around these products, and it makes a lot of sense for us to be following these up. If you end up asking me something I don't know off the top of my head, I will literally say I have no idea, and then we will get back to you, rather than me just sort of trying to guess. So in this instance, I know that's absolutely the case. You can use your lifetime ISA, but yeah, there are sort of complicated issues around the way that the lifetime ISA works. You know, there's things like, or what if I can't move into the property for 3 months based, or compared to what if I can't move into it for 5 months? So if you've got any of those really technical questions, we'll have to answer those sort of further down the track. But fundamentally, if it's just you with a lifetime ISA, you can use your lifetime ISA.
Perfect. I was definitely one of those people, me and my partner, she already had a home and I was a first-time buyer. So it's definitely possible. Another one is, can you transfer a Help to Buy ISA into a lifetime ISA?
You can. So the as I said, the way that it works is it will eat into your allowance for this year. So you can only, if you've got more than £4,000 in your Help to Buy ISA, you can only move £4,000 of it into your lifetime ISA in any given year. So you might have to stagger that over more than 1 year. It will then eat your lifetime ISA allowance for that particular year. But you can then put money elsewhere for the time being and then bung it all in. One of the great things about the lifetime ISA is it doesn't have to be done drip fed throughout the year. If you've got a big lump sum, you can pop it all in at once. And obviously you'll be getting the bonus on that money as well. So you can make the switch, but you need to understand the implications that it has on your overall lifetime allowance. Sorry, your overall lifetime ISA allowance.
Well, we had a quick follow-up from that was whether you think it could be a good idea to switch from a Help to Buy ISA into a LISA if you're planning to buy in the next 6 months. I think I know where you'll go with this answer.
Well, it does depend. If you've already got a lifetime ISA, then you've started the clock ticking. So what matters when you put your first pound into your lifetime ISA, you've got to leave a year between when you put your first pound in the lifetime ISA and when you take the money out. So if you already started the clock ticking a while ago, then you can make that transfer, even if you've got just 6 months left. You can transfer up to £4,000 of it. If you haven't started the clock, then it obviously means that you can't do it and then buy really quickly. But what that also means is if it's something that's on the horizon for you, that you think maybe I'll need a lifetime ISA at some point, maybe I'll be buying a house at some time, it's worth starting that clock ticking. You don't need to put in more than a pound in order to get your lifetime ISA open, which will then, once you've got it open, then you've that year starts moving. So it's something that a lot of people do is before they, because obviously you can get it between 18 and 39. A lot of people, you know, 39-year-olds think, well, I just may as well, you know, why not? And put a pound in just to secure that allowance. Definitely worth thinking about.
That's definitely a good point. A couple more based around licenses. If I open a lifetime ISA now, will I get my government bonus straight away?
Yeah, so that changed. So one of the odd rules about with the lifetime ISA was the first year that it was introduced, it got a bit complicated, and that wasn't the case. Now we're more than a year down the line, it's very straightforward. Each month you get that bonus. So you don't have to wait until the very end of the year for the bonus.
Perfect. Got one on guarantor mortgages now, so testing your knowledge. To do a guarantor mortgage, does the guarantor need to be working and not retired?
That's a very good question. I can definitely look into it. They will be mainly concerned about their ability to guarantee the mortgage. So a lot of it will depend on their income and obviously their home ownership. But that's one I'm really happy to look into and then get back to you. I think if you've asked it anonymously, if you could let us know details about who you are. But if you've given us your details, then we'll be able to follow it up.
Okay, it was anonymous, but we're always happy to have more questions that get us thinking on different angles. The more we can give you, the better.
Yeah.
A couple more about, I'm not so sure when I'll want to buy a home due to current interest rates. Should I be staying in cash or should I be investing?
That's a very good question. It comes down, I mean, I don't think you need to know down to the sort of the minute in order to make this, minute's not the word, but you know, if it's 6 months or it's a year or it's 3 years or it's 4 years, all of that is cash. If you're thinking, I don't really know how long, it might be 5 years, it might be seven, then that's an investment sort of time scale. So obviously, you know, you have to be happy with investing, but that's an investing time scale. So if you're thinking, well, interest rates are going to be high, say, for example, we know that interest rates are going to be elevated like this for maybe, let's say, up to a year. I mean, that is obviously finger in the air guesswork stuff. But let's say if they're like that for a year, then we are, I mean, the Bank of England keeps forecasting, very, very optimistic Bank of England keeps going, oh, do you know, we're going to be back at 2% in no time. But they are forecasting that, you know, 3 years ahead, we will be seeing significant drops. They're expecting there to be some sort of more insecurity within the UK economy a bit further ahead. That's why, for example, you'll see if you get a 5 year mortgage, you get a much better deal than a 2 year mortgage, because banks are expecting rates to do that and then to do that during that 5 year period. So roughly, we're expecting rates to fall back within 5 years. So if it's just the rates that's driving that decision, then it looks like it's going to be roughly a 5 year timescale. Can't guarantee anything. But again, you know, if you're thinking, I don't know if it's going to be 7 years or 8 years, then obviously we're moving into the investment territory.
Yeah, so it stays down to those timescales, whether it's buying property in general. Another one about the different ways you can couple up. So if I do it now, the only way to get on the property ladder is with a friend. Is that advisable? Should I be wary of this? Or could I be better off waiting a few more years?
It's a really good question. And it will come down to your relationship with your friend. You know, if you've been friends for a long time, first of all, have you lived together? You know, because if you buy with a friend and discover you're not compatible, it's just a disaster. But, you know, if you've got a friend that you are able to work through difficult things, it's worth considering whether that friendship has been tested in any way. Because it will be tested if you buy together. So, for example, you know, if one of you decides to move in with somebody else, you know, I don't know, partner or just somebody else, then that's going to be a test, because you're going to have to go through the process of, well, one of you will have to sell, or maybe both of you will have to sell, or whatever it is. So it will be a test for your friendship. So it's definitely worth starting with a friend that you know you can go through this sort of thing. There'll be some people who find it incredibly difficult to work through this sort of thing and really don't want to damage their friendship, and that's their utter priority, and for them they may prefer to wait. It comes down really to, you know, your approach, your friendship, and whether you think it's something that when you get to the tough bit of owning a home together, you'll be able to get through it.
Yeah, it's a surefire way to make or break a friendship, isn't that?
But then, you know, I personally know lots of people who've done it and it's worked brilliantly. So, you know, I wouldn't be afraid of it, definitely.
Certainly. We've got a few more on mortgages coming up. So when applying the estimated 4.5 multiplier to my salary, should I be subtracting deductions such as pension contributions?
So, yes, that's a really good point. So there are two things that they'll consider when they're looking at how much to lend to you. One is the overall total sum. And that they will apply the multiplier to, and that's just a straightforward multiplier of income. The other thing they look at is affordability, and then they will look at all your other deductions, and they'll look at any regular outgoings, and they'll look at whether or not they think it's affordable. They'll also, when they're doing that affordability calculation, they'll build in, you know, what will happen if interest rates go up as well, so that you can't just afford it today, you can afford it if interest rates go up a bit further as well. So you will need to pass those affordability tests, but when it's really just looking at that basic multiplier, then no, it's much more straightforward. It's just a multiplier of income.
Yeah, perfect. Probably got time for two or three more, so we'll continue with, if you buy a property with someone like your parents who already have a property, would you have to pay the additional stamp duty?
That's a really, really good point. And it's one of the reasons why buying with a parent is a bit fraught with difficulty. So yes, you would. It's a second property for them. So therefore it comes with the extra stamp duty. They also need to consider the fact that the point at which it's sold, it's a second property for them. So there will be capital, assuming that they make money on it, there could be capital gains tax to pay as well. So buying with a parent, this is why one of the options, you know, assuming they're happy, assuming they're happy with it, one of the options is to have a joint mortgage, but a single owner, and that owner is you. It might be that they want to buy in and they consider it an investment. And as long as they understand that there will be that extra stamp duty and that they're prepared for what will happen if, I don't know, you were to lose your job and they have to step in and pay the mortgage, as long as they're prepared for all of those things, then it's not impossible to buy together, but you just need to understand the downsides.
More general one here, think about, what are your thoughts about the UK housing market at the moment?
Well, I mean, I think I have two separate thoughts about the housing market. So one of the things I would say is that personally, when you buy a house, you're buying somewhere to live, and it's really easy to get sort of overwhelmed by what's happening with the market. Where's it going? What does it mean? And forget about the me in that process. So if you need security, if you know there's certain, some, you know, you need to live somewhere, or it often happens, you know, people, the average age of buying a first home is quite similar to the average age of having a first child, and it'll often be people want to have that security of, you know, not being kicked out and having to put down roots somewhere else once you've just got all that complicated childcare business in place. So it comes down to what you need in your life. So my own view is, if you need to buy, you shouldn't be afraid of what's going to happen to house prices that makes you stop buying. If it's affordable for you, if you're there for the long term, it doesn't have to be driven by what's going to happen to house prices. So my other view is sort of taking a sort of step back and taking the personal out of it. I think house prices are going to fall from here. I don't think they're heading for a crash. This is just my own personal view based on, you know, what's happening. I think one of the things that all the commentators on the housing market will say is they are surprised by how resilient house prices have been. And it's partly underpinned by just how resilient the jobs market's been. And it's also partly underpinned by just how expensive it is to rent and, you know, shortage of houses. So there are those reasons, for those reasons, that they're not going to change dramatically over the coming sort of months, sort of, I don't know, let's say 6 months, they're not going to change dramatically. So we're not expecting there to be any sort of loosening of what's underpinning house prices. We've seen them fall down quite gradually. I think we'll continue to see that happen towards the end of the year. And then a lot will depend on how long it takes for the Bank of England to start making cuts to interest rates. I think one of the things to really bear in mind as well is because most people get a fixed rate mortgage, when the Bank of England increased everybody's, you know, increased the base rate, it meant that the point at which you remortgage, it becomes much, much more expensive. So it actually is hitting people really hard, but it's only doing so really gradually. So in each given month, it's not that all mortgage owners suddenly have a load more. It's actually that another portion of homeowners do. So this is going to have a really long tail. So it means that over the next, you know, I reckon, because we've been doing this for a while now, but it could still be the next 4 years, there'll be a bunch of people coming to the end of their mortgages and having to remortgage. And so for as long as interest rates remain elevated, the more people who come to remortgage, then that's going to keep having a knock-on effect. There will still be people who are remortgaging, can't afford it, need to sell up. And so you will see weakness persist. So I don't think we're going to get massive crash, massive rise. I think we're going to get gradual tail down, gradual tail up, and that will take a fairly long period of time. Again, sorry, I should say, just my view.
And certainly you're the one with more information, so it's good to get your opinion on it. We've got just two more to run through. One of these, jumping back to ISAs, someone wants to know, once the first whole year of the ISA passes, will we be able to claim for the following months until we remove, or do we have to wait for a whole other year to get that bonus again?
No, so you'll get it on a monthly basis. So the reason why they don't want you to do, I mean, it's just one of those rules that's been built in that you have to hold it for a year. And the only reason they do that is to stop people sort of recycling it, sort of sticking it in for a month and then taking it straight out and making it £1,000 off the government. So that's the only reason they make you wait for a year. The bonus comes in every month. It's just that you can't take the money out until a year has passed.
Perfect, nice and easy, that one. So for our final one, it's, if I do buy at the moment, I'm worried about fixing my mortgage at these high rates for too long with the current outlook. What are your thoughts?
Yes, I mean, I really, really wish there was a right and a wrong answer here. It comes down to with a mortgage, it comes down to how important certainty is to you. So if, for example, you need to know how much you're spending over the next 5 years, then a 5-year mortgage is a very attractive option for you. A 5-year mortgage is actually currently cheaper than a 2-year mortgage, as I said, because the market is expecting that when those 2-year mortgages expire, that rates will be lower, so people will be able to get a cheaper mortgage. That's obviously just what they're expecting rather than what will necessarily happen. But that's why at the moment you're getting a cheaper option on your 5-year fix. So if you've got certainty as paramount to you, and it's such a big chunk of your outgoings, that's why so many people fix, because they don't want to have to think, oh, I wonder what it'll cost next month. They want to know what it's worth. However, there are people for whom paying the least possible is the key. So some people will, for example, go for a variable rate now on the understanding it's going to go up a bit and then it's going to hold for a bit and then it's likely to fall. So they think, well, I'm prepared to take that risk on that it won't stop going up, that some big surprise will come from nowhere and actually it'll go up a lot more. I'm prepared to take that risk on because overall I'm expecting to pay less. So there'll be some people who are comfortable with that. It is all down to how much flexibility you've got in your budget and how comfortable you are and how much you're prepared to pay for certainty. We know, because of the patterns of how people behave, we know most people value certainty over getting the cheapest possible deal, hopefully. But it really is such a personal decision about what's important to you. I think, if you're looking at, do I fix for 2 years? Do I fix for 5 years? It just comes down to how long do I need certainty for? If you fix for 5 years, you will definitely get a cheaper rate for the next 5 years than you would if you'll definitely get a cheaper rate over the next 2 years than you would with a 2-year mortgage, if you see what I mean. But you don't know whether or not it'll be cheaper after that, because you don't know what's going to happen to mortgage rates.
So yeah, that balance of affordability and peace of mind is definitely something I encountered. I'm definitely on the view of getting as good a deal as possible, but my partner's definitely on that. I'd rather know exactly what we're doing and consistency for as long as possible.
And a lot of it also comes down to wiggle room, how much space you've actually got in your budget. Because if you're in a position where you think, your mortgage, you're fit to bust, you can't afford another penny more, then certainty is going to just take that priority.
Yeah, definitely. That brings us to the end of today's webinar. And on such a lovely day, I'm more than happy to end a few minutes early. Feels like we're getting out of school a bit early. Nice run around in sunshine. Just a reminder, we'll be sharing recordings of today's and all of this week's webinars at a later date, either via email, and some will be going up on the HO YouTube channel. If there was anything that Sarah discussed today that caught your attention and you want to find out more and how HO can help you, pass it on, please do. Scan the QR code at the end here, tell you a bit more information about the lifetime ISA, or feel free to get in touch with us and ask us any further questions. Thank you once again, Sarah, and thank you everyone for joining us, and we hope you have a wonderful rest of the day.
Thanks very much.